adjusting my volume here.
Yeah. All right, Susan, we got 15 minutes. What's going on?
So I have an 8-year-old border collie Aussie cross.
Yep.
She's compulsive, obsessive compulsive, and she basically is completely unpredictable around anything that she's unfamiliar with, and even things that she is familiar with, that she's had some exposure to, she just reacts. She just goes berserk. So she's got a bite history, both human and dog.
Mm-hmm.
And I've had her since a pup.
Mm-hmm.
And she's kind of developed these behaviors at around two years old.
Mm-hmm.
So I have her on a prong. I've been following you for, I don't know, 4 or 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm using an e-collar. I've got her manageable.
Mm.
But she can't, she's just seems to be unable to do it on her own. So
right.
she can't be off leash. If she knows you, she's fine. If she knows the dog, she's fine. But anything new, so you come across everything new every single day.
Yep, we sure do.
And, yeah, so it's really quite a challenge with her. And so I'm just wondering if there's anything different or more that I could be doing.
Sure.
Because what I'd like to do is try to get her to be able to not react if I can.
Yeah.
But it's certainly been a challenge.
Okay. So as far, so we'll talk about obviously reactions. Reactivity's got to get a punisher, and then non-reactivity's got to get a reward, which could be a couple of things. It could be just literally, we can do a clicker food protocol, or just lack of a punisher, believe it or not, can be a reward too on some dogs. But we always want to have a very clear, you know, yes and a very clear no, with no nothing in the middle there, so the dog understands that, you know, what we don't want and what we do want. So, for instance, what are some common triggers for your dog that are like environmental?
So inside the house, she reacts to the changing of the cycle of the dishwasher.
Got it.
And she will, so if she's not on place, she will go rush the dishwasher and will bite the bottom of the dishwasher.
Okay, great. So that's a great thing to start with right there, because number one, you can eliminate it. Number two, it's a choice the dog's making. So, you know, and the dog checks out medically, like hearing is fine, and medically they're fine. The dog's fine.
Yeah, she's
okay.
Good.
Okay. So what I would do is this: if my dog was charging my dishwasher, I would use a bonker or a remote collar. So have you used a bonker yet?
Yeah, and she thinks the bonker is a play toy.
Got it. Have you used it very, very firmly? Like,
I've smacked her over the head.
Got it.
She'll stop.
Right.
But then she'll pick up the toy, like she'll pick up the towel.
Yeah.
And she'll bring it back to me.
Got it. Okay. So so on the remote collar, just like counter surfing we would do, or anything we want to stop, you know, on a permanent basis, what we would do is we would use the remote collar. You know, the dog races towards the dishwasher. Have used the remote collar as a punisher?
Yeah.
Okay, and the dog just keeps, obviously the dogs keep doing it. That's why we're having this conversation. So
I think I'm under stimming.
Underwhelming. A lot of people do. So are you using which brand of e-collar are you using?
The Dogtra.
Okay, Dogtra. The 280 or the 1900 or the Yark? Do you know which
Eight.
One? 280. Okay. So your dog races towards the dishwasher. You want to say no, and then you want to give a stim at a punisher level. What level are you doing it at?
I've done it at 25.
Mm-hmm. So, and are you saying no first?
Yes.
Okay. So yes. So 25 is not enough for most dogs that are in drive that are going to be biting things, to eliminate that behavior.
She feels it.
Right, right.
Like she feels it, but it's not, like, I guess you're right, it's not enough to kind of go, it's not worth stopping.
Right, it's nagging. So what you're doing is you're nagging the dog.
It doesn't look like nagging.
I know,
she's audible, and like she screams when I do it.
Right.
But it's, go ahead.
So it's like, but to the dog, it just stops in the day, but it doesn't keep them from doing it again. So, you know, when you put a good punisher in there, the dog should stop. So you should see them actually go, like, they're going to start self-correcting. They're going to go, oop, I want to do it, but I'm not going to do it. And then you know you're making progress. So okay. I would go up really high. I would almost compare it to, you know, a lot of the act of God stuff we do, such as counter surfing, getting the litter box, getting in the trash. I firmly believe that that's something that the dog is making a choice on. They're choosing to do it. That therefore they can choose not to do it. So once you put the big punisher in and you eliminate that, so I would go high. If my dog every time the dishwasher chain cycle attacked my dishwasher, I mean it's my personal property, and it's like, you know, I can't have you doing that. If a child was in the way, or a guest was in the way, or someone was in the way, you know, the dog might bite them. We've seen that. So what I would do is I would do it at an extremely high level, probably at 100, and I would hold the button down for 3 seconds. And it would be ugly, you know, it's not pretty, but your dog has a habit of doing this on a lot of different environmentals, not just this one thing. Always say no first. Then what I would do is I would go to a clicker food protocol, where now what we're going to do is run the dishwasher, and then we're going to start doing, even while the whole dishwasher is going, I would put the dog in place, and then if you can tell on your numeric dial or whenever your dishwasher is going to change cycle, but I would do it frequently while the dishwasher is running. Has your dog been clicker trained at all? Does it understand what a clicker is? Okay, great. So click food. But I also want the dog to be rewarded only for the state of mind, not just for physically staying on place. So if the dog is on place, but it looks like it's like ready to pounce, I would actually correct that. Not act of God correction, but I would actually give that dog a correction because their intent is to spring off of place. It's almost like they're loaded, ready to go. So to me, I want that dog to be like calm. So then what I would do is I would click reward during courses of the dishwasher. As you get closer to maybe the change of the cycle, click reward. Even if the dog gets aroused when that change of the cycle on the dishwasher happens, I would say no. And again, not act of God stuff, but pretty strong. We want to eliminate the intent as well. So we don't want to just eliminate the physical action of racing. We want to eliminate the intent of doing it. And the reason why is because I don't always want to have my dog in place to prevent it from doing a bad behavior. I want the dog to know that rushing the dishwasher at any time is not a good idea. So now that you've established that's something easy to do because you can set that up very easily. You can just just run your dishwasher. Even if it's on a short cycle, just run your dishwasher, whether it's empty or full, doesn't matter. And you can literally turn that into a training exercise. That's probably the first thing I would go after is that. But even at 25 is, sure, the dog stops, but it's sort of like, your dog's up on the counter, you go in and you say no, and your dog gets down. It stopped in the moment, but tomorrow it's going to go back up on that counter. So your dog is really good at like jumping, you know, getting down from the counter, but it's not good at never going up on the counter again. So that's what I do. When you've got a lot of these repetitive behaviors that have been going on for a while, and if your dog has a systematic, you know, lifestyle that it sounds like, I mean, I read your email, it's going after a lot, it's doing this with a lot of things.
Just everything. Yeah.
So you've got it's turned into a habit. It's turned into pretty much a trained behavior with your dog. So, you know, are you going to have to do every single thing? Probably not. But I would, that would be an easy one to do. Number one, it's inside the house. You know, you don't have to go outside. You can set it. You can set it up. It's predictable. That's the first thing that I would do. And then see where you go from there. But it's always got to be that no first, because I want that word no to be all powerful. I want that to be such a huge, you know, just a huge, and then you have to always follow up with a consequence. So you always have to follow up with something. So, you know, remote collar on your dog now, probably, you know, wake up in the morning, remote collar goes on the dog, you know, and then at night, take the remote collar off. And then over the course of the day, obviously switch sides so they don't get pressure sores. So that's the kind of thing I would do. And as far as, you know, on your walks, your dog's getting aroused as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. people walking, so certain people that walk by, certain people with dogs that walk by, not bikes, but rollerbladers, scooters, skateboarders, not necessarily like squirrels or animals or anything like that, but I don't know what causes this, but that's what she does.
I mean, it's just arousal. I mean, your dog is highly aroused, and that's what a lot of it is. But also now habit. It's just habit. I mean, the dog is like, it's predictable. So what I do, what I always do is, if I've got a dog like that, that as soon as you go outside and you start your walk, you've got a dog that's already sort of on alert. You know, we see this all the time. So is that what's going on with your dog? They're just like ready to go. Is your dog relaxed at the beginning of the walk?
They're ready to go. Like I have two, but yeah, she's ready to go. But it's not sort of like, okay, I'm looking everywhere to find out where I'm going to pounce.
Okay.
She's just excited, ready to go. Like she waits at the door for me before, like I walk out first. If I tell her to sit, she'll sit.
Yeah.
She's looking around to see what's going on, but it's not that same intensity as when down the street she'll see something. And then all of a sudden the body language changes.
Yep.
And then I know. So the body language is changing, so I know something's happening. So I'm looking up to see what's going on in my environment. If I see another dog, I kind of go, okay, is it on leash or off leash? Because if it's off leash, I'm in trouble. Because if it comes up to my dog, it's, you know, my dog's going to lunge.
Yep.
So, but I'm able to control her now.
Good.
With the prong.
Good.
I have the prong and the remote on her.
Okay.
And so I say no. And sometimes I do a about face and turn around. And then I wait until, like, I keep her attention on me.
Okay.
So that I turn around and I keep walking. And then I turn around and go back towards the offensive person or dog.
Right.
And with a few rotations like that, we are able to go by the dog without her completely flipping out.
Right.
Like she's on alert and she's watching that dog. And there's nothing I can do to break her eye contact.
Right.
So it's like I walk away is what I try to do.
So what I would do is this, and what we do is this very successfully, is as soon as your dog gets aroused, go to the, before you even look up to see what's there, remote.
Okay.
Use your remote. Look up second. Look up second, because by the time you look up and scan, your dog is already going up a level. So it's, and you don't need if you had a dog that wasn't reactive, who cares? Like none of this stuff matters. You know, it's like, oh, my dog can't look around. Of course your dog can look around, but not if it explodes. You know, no, you can't look around. So, you know, if you're an alcoholic and you're just out of rehab, you can't go into a bar. Sorry. You know, you just can't do it. So it's the same with a dog. At the minute your dog gets aroused, that's when you give them the information with a remote collar that says, don't be aroused. Because, you know, if an off-leash dog is charging, like, that would be a major issue, but you'll be able to look up and see it. And, you know, but chances are it's going to be like all the other environmentals that your dog is struggling with. So what I do is as soon as I see if a dog is getting aroused, that's when we give the information with the remote collar. It's at a higher level. And then all of a sudden the dog literally should go into this, oh, especially if you've been working on focus work with your dog, the dog should immediately go, oh, I should pay attention to you. And I'm not looking for a competition heel out of these dogs. I'm looking for a dog that just doesn't care about anything out there anymore. And they only care about us. We'll keep them safe. We'll advocate for our dog. So when we do that over and over and over again, what we do is we see the dogs all of a sudden now pattern these new things. And what you're going to see is, and we see this every day, is the dog will still possibly glance at something, but they'll immediately then start self-correcting of going, oh, because they know the consequence. So are they looking up at you because they don't want to be punished or corrected? Yeah. But at the beginning, I'll take that. I'll take it. Because no reward historically is going to break your dog's concentration with a pattern behavior of explosion. You can hold a stake in front of your dog and your dog is still going to explode. Now what do you do? You're done. It's over with. You literally turn around and go the other way. So instead, and I don't want to keep the dog under threshold either because that's not practical. Because when your dog has got all these environmental stimuli that it reacts to, like, you won't even be able to go down the street because you've got, like, there's always going to be a cat or a dog or a truck or a, you know, we've got, you know, of anything. So to me, we absolutely will utilize space, though. So if I see a dog coming down the street on the same sidewalk, I, with my dog, I move off the sidewalk because I'm not interested in seeing if my dogs can pass another dog on a sidewalk, because chances are I just don't trust the other human. I don't trust the other dog. So, and I got nothing to prove. I'm like, I'm going in the street. Like, you can have, you go ahead, take the whole sidewalk if you want to. But from far distance, though, and for, you know, rodents, and for then any of the other environmental sounds, what I do is I'm like, we hold our ground, we keep moving, higher level correction, get the dog to be like, oh, that arousal is not good, and keep moving forward. You can also give a punisher at the beginning of the walk, which so many people struggle with that concept, because you're like, well, the dog really hasn't done anything, you know, but your dog's going to, not to think negative, but like, you've been struggling for years with this walk, like, instead, let me set the ground rules right from the beginning. Right from the beginning, you're not going to be aroused. You're not going to be reactive. You put your dog in a different state of mind. At the very beginning of this process, sometimes you'll have a dog that like, oh my God, I hate the walk. Don't worry. It all, like, you hate the walk now. That's all I really care about. You know, it all evens out. It'll all even out. So try that. What I would do is I'd flip it. High punisher at the beginning of the walk. As soon as the dog is aroused, punisher. Right now it's not going to be much reward based because it's just like your dog's not doing anything to warrant it, you know, and a reward for a lot of dogs gets the dog to be too excited. A dog gets too excited, they do stupid stuff. So,
yeah, I noticed that because when I did the remote and then she didn't react, I would say, oh, good girl. And as soon as I said, good girl, up she went. Somebody just came in the door.
Yep.
So up she went.
I know.
She didn't go high, but you could tell that, oh God, I just got her excited again.
Exactly.
She was doing so well.
I know. That's why a lot of people, like when our shows, our video, people are like, well, why didn't you praise the dog? It did good. Because if I our goods are this, good. It's a marker. It's literally just a marker. It's good. If I go, good job, like, they'll explode again. So eventually, can you? Of course you can. But right now, nope, you can't. You can't. So right now, it's going to be more punishment-based than balanced. It's going to be like more punishment-based. And then all of a sudden, once your dog starts doing good on a repetitive basis, now you can start going good, good, good. And you'll probably get a tail wag. You'll probably get like a little pep in the step. But you know, especially with this dog, and we've worked with so many dogs like this, they get aroused. And what do? Boom, they explode. So now here you go. You just told your dog how good they are. And then 2 minutes later, you're like, great, we're back. We're back to square one. So, all right.
Yeah. So that's great. Yeah.
All right.
Can I just want one more quick question?
Sure.
When you get to the reward base.
Yes.
So, how do you, like with the dishwasher example, it's basically click and reward when when she's calm, but she's got to work at getting calm before that happens.
Yeah.
So what if that's not happening?
At the beginning, you can do more clicking and rewarding and then start taking away reward, do variable rewards. But right now, again, it's going to be a lot of just punishers. Because the last thing I need my dog to do is to be excited in the house with a dishwasher going. So I want my dog to be literally just like, yep, there goes that dishwasher. Pfft, whatever. And if you really think about it, not attacking the dishwasher, like, I'm not going to reward you for that. You know what I mean? No. It's like, you're not supposed to do it. It's like, really? Like, so it sounds...
Why do you even care?
Yeah, it sounds a little bit cruel, but the bottom line is, like, it's always going to be a lot of the stuff that we do for stopping all these unwanted behaviors are heavy on punishment before you can even think about doing the reward. Like, but at the beginning, to start giving that transition, you can start rewarding, but eventually you're going to just like, you're not going to reward for not attacking a dishwasher. Like, that's just, that doesn't make sense. But right now, punishment and then start a little bit of reward, and eventually it's just, like, I'm not rewarding you. I'm just going to punish you if you attack the dishwasher. It's like, oh, you didn't steal from Walgreens, you know, Angelo? Good job. Here's $5. It's like, I'm not going to reward my child for, like, not, like, you know, not
normal stealing. Behavior.
Yes. Yeah. There's a level of expectation that we expect from our children and our dogs. And, and there shouldn't be massive rewards for, like, being like a civilized person and a civilized dog, but there has to be a punisher for doing dangerous behaviors or unwanted behaviors, both, you know, with, and I'm going to compare it to kids because everybody else wants to play the kid game. So, you know, so that's just how we think of dog training a lot.
Okay.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Take care. Thanks. All right. Yep. Bye-bye.